Anna Slavich, while I briefly present you, you can prepare your slides. So Dr. Anna Slavich is a consulting statistician at INARU Center of Excellence, where her primary role is to support the development and implementation of the Institute Data Management Plan and assist other researchers with data collection, analysis, and reporting. And at INARU, her research focuses the use of statistics in sustainable building research. And in particular, she's interested in projects that apply survey methods. Anna Slavich was also a Research Data Alliance ambassador European ambassador for engineering and renewable materials in 2019 and 2020. Anna, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Marike, for the introduction. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Anna Slavich, and I'm a consulting statistician and researcher at the INARU Center of Excellence. And I will start by introducing our institution, what kind of research we do. The institute is quite new. We were established in 2017 through a Horizon 2020 project. And we are an independent research institute. And we have about 70 employees, and we have 6 research groups that are dealing with different topics, from human health in the built environment, wood modification, renewable materials composites, sustainable building with renewable materials. Then we have the ICT in renewable materials and sustainable building, and the smallest one, the experimental data, the data analysis group. So as you see, none of these groups cover the circular economy. So research on circular economy is something we do on the side, because it's a topic important to us, because our institute is collaborating a lot with the industry. And we also have a living lab, where the members are different stakeholders, including enterprises in the wood sector and other related sectors. And because of that, the topic of circular economy is somehow related to a lot of other things we do. And on the next slide, I will present you our research projects that are related to circular economy. So the first two are two projects where I'm actually involved as a researcher. One is about, actually it already ended, it was about the revitalization of traditional industry. And we were interested in innovation for the Slovenia's furniture sector, but not only furniture, for the full forest wood sector in Slovenia. And a similar project that's a continuation, so it's a current project, it's a continuation of this one. We're doing a study on innovation activities of Austrian and Slovenian enterprises in the wood value chain. So the topic is not directly circular economy, but there were in us also, we are interested also in aspects that are related to circular economy. So how enterprises deal with the effects of climate change and how the innovations are related to climate change. Then we have projects where I'm not directly involved. So it's projects mostly by other groups. Our ICT group is mainly involved. And there are projects about the optimization of supply chain, about optimization of residual biomass value chain, and this one about reverse logistic network for residual. So what they're trying to do is they're looking at this, especially focusing on wood material, on wood and other renewable materials. They're looking at these waste materials and how they can be reused. And they're using network analysis, they're using life cycle analysis, and so on. Then I would like to mention two specific projects where we are involved, but we are not the leaders of these two projects. One is Wood Circus, which is not so much a research project, it's more The project is more about policy making and dissemination, and it's led by an organization in Finland, so we are involved as a partner. And it is about the role of the forest-based sector in the circular bioeconomy. And the last one is the woods is the Wolf project, where the leader is an enterprise in Slovenia, Msora, that is producing window frames, and they were interested in consumer attitudes towards using residual wood to make wooden frames, which is of course more friendly for the environment, but it's also more expensive. So we conducted a survey for them regarding the attitudes of consumers on this topic. And it's a topic which is, because it's very specific, so it's something that in the available secondary data we were not able to find, so we were we conducted our own study for this project. And then based on my experience working on these projects and on discussions with other researchers, so to prepare to this presentation today, I had a meeting, so I met with my colleagues who are dealing with similar topics. And based on my experience and their experiences, I made an overview of what are the issues regarding the use, the secondary use of data on the top circular economy. So first, like an overview, what are the different sources? Mainly a lot of us, we use the data from the Statistical Office and Eurostat. In case of my research, it was mainly the Community Innovation Survey, but for other studies, there were also other data sets available through Eurostat. Then we had also data from the Slovenian Forestry Institute, which is mostly aggregate data, not micro data. And also others, they have, so my colleagues, they have collected data directly from enterprises. So they asked companies that they collaborate with to share with them their internal data about waste management, about electrical consumption, water use, salary ranges, materials use, and so on. Because this data is then needed for life cycle analysis and other kind of analysis. Just a comment, so for my other research, not related to circular economy, I'm a user of the SESDA catalog, so for other purposes, but for this kind of research, for this project, I was not using, so I was not able to find something because we were interested in very specific issues, and usually they we're interested on this on the level of an enterprise, not on the end consumer. So we were mostly interested about enterprises and their attitudes and behavior. Okay, and now the summary of what were our issues with using this data from Eurostat and other sources that I listed. We were not able to find data for certain categories of units. For example, my main challenge was that most of the enterprises in this sector, but not only in this sector, I think across all the sectors, are micro enterprises. Micro enterprises are enterprises with less than 10 employees. But if you look at the official statistic data from Eurostat, they only have data for small, medium, and large enterprises. So they only include enterprises with at least 10 employees. So with that, for this forest wood sector, you're missing 90% of the enterprises. So the secondary data available is not enough for us, and we had to conduct our own survey so that we could see how the micro enterprises are dealing with this topic. Then my colleagues working on optimization problem, they had the issue that they couldn't find network data between different actors in the system. So instead of using actual data, they had to make simulations. As I mentioned, in the Wolf project, we were interested in very specific attitudes that are not covered in other surveys. And something that came across also is these timeliness issues. That the data is currently available only up to a certain year, And if you want to work with the most recent data, there is a very long wait. And that is an issue for researchers, especially if you work with enterprises where they're interested in the most current data. And to improve maybe the reusability of this data, there should be maybe some improvements made in how quickly the data is prepared for researchers to be reused. And the second issue is that often you can only get aggregate data and there is no microdata. And for example, then some data is available only on yearly level but for some things like waste management, there are big differences in between seasons. So these differences between different months, seasons are important. So having just yearly data is not enough. And researchers are interested to have more precise data on a daily or at least maybe weekly or monthly level. And then often we have only the total sum of data available without specific subcategories. So when we have waste data processing data, it's not easy to know if we're interested in specific materials. We just know the total waste, but if we are interested in more details about the waste, about the format, what the materials are, often this kind of data is not available. And maybe you can find data across different sources, but you have issues then in connecting them because it comes in different formats and patterns. So there are also these interoperability issues. And even if you can access, sometimes you can access microdata, but it's available only under very strict protection measures. My colleagues that worked with data from enterprises, they got this data, but they got them only under this strict non-disclosure agreement. So you can use the data, but when you publish something from them, it's difficult because you cannot publish the data. So there is this issue of reproducibility of research because the data you got from the enterprises, you're not allowed to use it, so to share it with others. In statistics, official statistics, so my experience with the use of Eurostat data, I got access to Eurostat data. But there was a problem that, so you can get a VPN option, but it requires some rental of equipment, which is an additional cost. And then you can use, or there is a possibility, so this was in the case of the Slovenian Statistical Office, that there was this rental of equipment. But for Eurostat, we got access, but we had this problem that we can only work on it through desktop computers. And most of our researchers, we have laptops, so this is an issue because at the institute we just have two desktop computers, and so this is maybe a small inconvenience that we encountered. And then there is a possibility in Slovenia, so and also probably other statistical offices, they offer the possibility to use their safe room, but the amount and frequency of data export is limited, and you're not allowed then to export values below a certain threshold. So it's very inconvenient for researchers. It's a long procedure. So you go there, you prepare, so you do some analysis, and then you cannot export it directly, but it goes through a data protection check. And so all the values that are below a certain level need to be covered. So it's a long process and it's not convenient. So it takes a lot of time. We of course understand that data protection is very important, but on the other hand, you know, there could be some way of trying to find some balance, some middle ground, because I believe that it's also possible to protect data also with less strict measures. So there are the technology, it makes possible data analysis in a safe environment. So sometimes these protection measures, they are maybe overprotective. So of course it is important to protect the identity of enterprises that participate, but there should be maybe more effort to find, to make it more user-friendly for researchers. Okay, that was all from my part today, and I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Thanks a lot, Anna. I think those were very important topics that you addressed.